our election. Here is what we know for sure. The goal was clear. Help Trump, okay? And the Russians used just about every social media platform imaginable. The scope of the efforts, unprecedented. But here is really what needs more investigating. The tactics that the Russians used were really, really similar to what we saw from Team Trump. Prove it. Okay. Exhibit A. The Senate's report shows that Russia was targeting three groups to suppress the vote with ads like these. The Senate focuses especially on the ads targeting African Americans, saying they designed these to suppress the vote in that community. All right? That's the point that they're making. Fine. Now look at this article from Bloomberg in 2016. They're all yelling at me in the control room. You went too fast, TV. All right. So what do we see? In this was supposed to be the goal. Okay. That's the Russians. A senior Trump official was quoted in Bloomberg in 2016 saying, "We have three major voter suppression operations underway." What were they? The same three groups: African-Americans, young women, white liberals. The Russians were putting out ads like these, and Trump was targeting African-Americans with an animation using Hillary Clinton's 1996 claim about super predators. See the similarity? The reason Trump's own people, here's what they said: it will dramatically affect her ability to turn these people out. Now, I'm not saying it's a crime. I'm saying it's uncanny. The symmetry continued right up until the end. In the days leading up to the campaign, the actual election, the Russians went all in on what? Allegations of voter fraud, warnings that the election would be stolen. Sound familiar? Of course it does. You were hearing the same exact thing from then candidate Donald Trump, tweeting about the exact same messages. What's the argument going to be here? Can't be this simple, right? It won't be. They'll say they were just using the tools available to them. Trump, the Russians, simply knew how to use social media better than the Democrats. But remember this. Steve Bannon was a key player at Cambridge Analytica, right? They're the ones that were brought in, Jared Kushner, why he picked them, why would they help out in the election. And remember, Bannon and Cambridge Analytica had ties to Russian oil and a St. Petersburg university. Remember all that? We also know the Russians took Trump up on his offer to try to find Hillary's emails. Remember that? The goals and tactics of the Russians and the Trump campaign were very similar. That much can be shown. We just did it. But why were they so similar? That is for lawmakers or Mueller to expose. But it is a provocative question. We're going to talk with one of the key senators who put out that bombshell report today. What does he think about the Flynn 302? Did he know about it? What's of interest to him? And what is he going to do about this provocative question, the similarities between the Russians and Trump's campaign?
This is CNN, the most trusted name in news.
Today's Senate report illustrates that the Russians exploited a massive backdoor into the foundation of our democracy. The question has always been, find out what the Russians did and then stop them from doing it again. Where are we on that? Now, one of the people who will soon have a bigger say in all that is Democratic Senator from Oregon, Ron Wyden. Senator, a pleasure. Welcome to primetime.
Thank you, Chris.
All right, so let's deal with this central question, just in terms of the politics versus process. Where are we in your estimation in terms of understanding what the Russians did and having a plan that can be executed to make it less likely that it happens again?
We have a long way to go, Chris, in order to protect the American people and protect the integrity of our elections. Let me give you an example. Facebook clearly was very slow to pick up on what was going on with Instagram. And the Russians were targeting Instagram because that was the pipeline for young people. That was where the voters were. That was where the swing voters were. And the fact of the matter is these social media companies, these big companies like Facebook, have got to be much more vigilant and much more aggressive going forward.
Well, but Senator, look, I mean, you know, you're a smart guy. I've seen you in the hearings. You know that they can do better than they're doing. I mean, if you and I were online having a conversation about our favorite foul shooters from the 80s, you and I would be getting all kinds of ads for throwback jerseys. You know, they know how to monitor conversations when it suits them. And whether it's Zuckerberg or whomever, they come in front of you guys and they either shine you on or they seem to give selective attribution to why they do things, when are you going to just drop the hammer on them and say, look, we know and you know that you have to do better, and if you don't, here's what's happening?
Chris, I'm dropping the hammer on them right now with my privacy bill. And this, of course, involves Cambridge Analytica, which was a key company in this story. What I'm going to say in my privacy bill is if the CEO at one of these big technology companies lies to the federal government, like the Federal Trade Commission, if they lie to the federal government about their privacy policy and how it affects their consumers, they would pay a big fine and also face the prospect of jail time. That is dropping the hammer, my friend.
It'll be interesting to see how that plays. I'm sure you've been talking to them about what their take is on the buildup to the bill, but I'll be following that, and that's good to hear. Senator, I just laid out in the wall that there are some really interesting similarities between what the Trump campaign did and what the Russian troll farms and accounts were doing on social media. Do you believe that's just a coincidence, that it's about savvy use of social media and obvious messaging? Or is there something to the similarity?
This is another question going forward, Chris, because Mr. Parscale, who was the digital director before, seems like he's going to be the guy in 2020.
Yes.
So there are some real questions that ought to be asked about what he did in his relationship with Cambridge Analytica. But I come back to the fact that this highlights the need for a privacy bill like mine, which has real teeth and real enforcement capacity.
Look, I'm all about that. I mean, look, we have to figure out in our society how we balance privacy with access and the reach that we want. It's going to be evolving, but all the main players have to know they have skin in the game, and they're going to lose some skin if they don't play the game the right way. But I don't understand why this question's not getting more play. You know, the specific ads, the specific groups, the specific tactics that the Trump campaign used, how could they have come up with the same parameters as Russian troll farms?
Again, going forward, it better get some more play. For example, just today, the NAACP said that there ought to be an investigation into how the Russians targeted the African-American community. I strongly tonight stand with the NAACP. I'll be telling our chairman, Richard Burr, and Mark Warner, we ought to respond affirmatively to what the NAACP wants.
And look, I mean, if they're going to look into why they did it, why wouldn't you look into why the Trump folks did it? They admitted they were doing the same thing. They wanted to depress the vote or suppress the vote, not illegally, but to put out messaging that would keep African-Americans at home. And, you know, people can judge the politics. I'm not saying it's illegal, but I'm saying, wow, what a coincidence. They picked the same group and they did it with the same kind of messaging.
Look, there is a long history of, for example, politicians saying, I don't think we can get so-and-so to vote for our guy. Let's try to keep the other people home. What is different now is the social media companies have an obligation. They have an obligation to take this seriously, to be more vigilant, to catch it early on. I'll give you an example, Chris. If one of these companies has an address that says St. Petersburg on it, or the company gets paid in rubles, I mean, let's just face it, that ought to be a wake-up call, and the social media companies somehow didn't move in spite of that overwhelming evidence.
Even the Luddite knows that that's something to be suspicious of. Let me ask you one more thing while I have you, Senator. Have you had a chance to take a look at the 302 from Michael Flynn?
Chris, I heard what your earlier discussion was all about, and I, of course, as a member of the Intelligence Committee, can't get into specifics. But let me just cut to the bottom line. Mike Flynn is a general. He is an adult. He pled guilty to lying to the FBI, period. End of discussion. And I know we're going to have discussion in the press about all these various documents and the like. But to me, the bottom line is clear. They were talking about important matters like sanctions and Kislyak. He pled guilty to lying. Bob Mueller has been a straight arrow. He's been methodical, doesn't hold press conferences. And Flynn just pled guilty. And for me, that's the heart of the matter.
Let me push it. Just one step. You can always pretend like you didn't hear it. The IFB trick works very well for Angus King, by the way. The idea of why would General Flynn not take the suggestion from the agents that they knew what he had asked about? You know, he's an intelligence pro himself. He let them refresh his recollection with respect to the vote on Israeli settlements. He said, oh, thank you for that. Thank you for reminding me. They then tell him, hey, did you talk about sanctions? Did you talk about asking about what they would do? Obviously, they knew, but he lied. And it raises the question, who was he covering for? What did he put a higher value on than the truth in that one instance? Is that something that you guys are looking at?
Chris, again, I can't get into stuff that goes on in the committee, but let's just put it this way. In these kinds of things, there may be a host of possible explanations for Flynn stirring this up. Was he trying to get a better deal with Mueller? Was he hoping for a pardon? Who knows? But again, I just want to come back, and the essence of your question is logic. I mean, here you have somebody who's an adult. He should have understood that he was lying to the FBI. It's a serious matter. For me, that continues to be the bottom line.
Why lie? We ask it here all the time. Senator, thank you so much. Best for the holy days to you and your family.
Thanks so much.
All right. All right, here's a simple question, but we got to get to it. If there's a shutdown, who wins a shutdown over the wall? Great debate. Next. All right, so this record of this interview with General Flynn just came out tonight. Some of it's redacted, but you have to read it because there's this question that'll drive you crazy. The general was an intel expert. He knows they knew what he talked about with Kislyak. You can tell when you read this. Why did he lie? And then we have this other question. All this shutdown talk. Who wins if it happens? Let's debate two of the best. Jennifer Granholm and Rick Santorum. Help me with this first one. It's driving me crazy, Rick. We had been told that the 302 with Flynn was hidden because it would show that he was set up. It's nonsense. There's absolutely no indication of that in here. If anything, he clearly was driving the train throughout the entire interview, which explains why Strzok and McCabe, for all of the negativity they get from your side of the aisle right now, didn't think that he was lying. But indeed, he was, and he admits that now. Why do you think General Mike Flynn, when he had to know as an intel expert, these guys knew about his conversations, why did he lie?
My guess is because he didn't recall or maybe had thought differently. I mean, there really is no reason to lie. I mean, You say he lied to protect someone. Well, how are you protecting someone if they already know the information? He knew that they, in fact, I think he at some point references that they knew what he'd said because they thought he thought that they had that information. So the only reason someone who knows the other person has that information, and therefore you're not protecting anybody by lying because they have the information, the only reason you do it is because I suspect you don't recall or you recall it differently. And that's the only thing that comes to my conclusion. It certainly makes no sense for him to do it for any other reason.
Except he admitted that he lied, Jennifer, and it's interesting.
Well, he admitted that he lied that's a bigger story, Chris. I mean, you have the power of the federal government coming down on you.
You guys say that whenever it's convenient.
But you know what? But it's also true. And it's true for
Republicans and Democrats. Did you say that about Bill Clinton when he lied under oath? Did you say, well, he had to? I mean, they were coming after him.
That's a little different than having
it. Yeah, I know, because it worked to your advantage. That's all I'm saying. Look, but let me ask Jennifer this question, Rick. I hear you on it. But look, he admits he lied. Rick wants to say he had to. They were turning the screws on him. Whatever. It makes you wonder, those calls that he was making down there in the Dominican Republic, calls to Mar-a-Lago, conversations during those 18 days before they made a move on Flynn. And when they did, they never talked about any of the criminality that had been suggested to them by Sally Yates or anybody else. I wonder if he thought, I have to stay saying this because there are more people involved. Jennifer, what do you think? Empty speculation?
Of course. Of course. I mean, there was a whole question in the past couple of days about who from his firm was going to go before the grand jury. It's all wound up in that. We won't know the answer to it fully until Mueller's report is revealed. But I think there's so much of him trying to protect people he was working with, maybe his family, maybe his son. It's all bound in this. And that's why he lied. It was to cover up. You don't forget stuff like conversations like that, especially with all of the stuff swirling around Russia, et cetera. You don't forget that. He was trying to protect somebody, trying to cover up, and kind of was hoping, I'm sure, that this would somehow not rise to an offense that he'd be charged with.
Do you know how many conversations these folks have about these issues? And to suggest that he's lying to cover up, he knows they have the conversation. He's not covering up anything. This makes no sense. Makes no sense at all, other than the fact that he got it wrong.
Right.
Look, know that, Rick.
I'm not saying
He said it during the interview.
I'm not saying it.
They were prompting him about what he had talked about.
Just to be fair about the conversation, I'm asking about it because it doesn't make sense to me. And I'm hoping that it will
it make sense,
at some
point. That.
With the president and Rudy Giuliani, I get it. I get why the president lies about things. They're not getting ready for trial. They're getting ready for a publicity contest. Rudy's actions and words and deeds make perfect sense in that context. They're never going before a judge. I guarantee you those answers they gave Mueller were safe and open-ended. They gave it all to him. You know why? They don't want any trouble with him. But with us, they'll lie all day. All right, now the tough one for you, Jennifer. Hold on. You're going to like this, Rick. I don't get where you Democrats are on this shutdown. I don't get it. I think that the president has boxed you in because it seems like you don't care about border security. He's saying, I'll shut it down because it matters so much. And you guys are saying, Chuck, let's play the current state of play, and then you'll have the context and the audience will for my disposition. Here's the state of play.
We're going to do whatever is necessary to build the border wall to stop this ongoing crisis of illegal immigration.
And that means
this is a very, if it comes to it, absolutely.
President Trump should understand there are not the votes for the wall in the House or the Senate. He is not going to get the wall in any form.
So I don't get the politics because it sounds like, oh, he wants to build some brand new wall. And I get that was the original canard. But you know that they've moved off that and they call it a wall system now. And it seems like the Democrats, Jennifer, are saying, yeah, we're not into this border security the way he is.
Well, Democrats are into border security. They just want to do it in a smart way. And studies that have been done, even about the wall that's been built, there was a 2006 act called the Safe Fence Act or something like that, that ended up covering a third of the entire border between the U.S. and Mexico. And study was just out between Stanford and Dartmouth saying that it was by far way ineffective. The costs far outweighed the benefits. It did not significantly reduce immigration. It was by 0.6% reduction. There are much better ways to get at border security. And this president, who has said repeatedly that Mexico is going to pay for the wall and all that malarkey, the Democrats came to him and they said, we have two offers to make. One is pass the rest of the appropriations bills. We will make sure that we pass them in the Senate and then the House, and just put a continuing resolution, meaning just keep the Department of Homeland Security at the same level until we can figure out the resolution to these other issues like DACA, like a permanent solution to immigration, like border security that actually works. And he so far has been playing a bit of the drama queen and just dragging it out to the last minute. And even the Republicans who came out today from meeting with him this afternoon, John Cornyn said, we have no idea what he wants. He hasn't given us a signal or a plan.
Is it
so
true,
I
Rick?
Think the Democrats are in the right place.
Okay. Rick, is it true when you hear from Pelosi and Schumer, they seem real confident saying you don't have the votes on your side for this new wall. You hearing that?
I'm not hearing that. And the reality is that the votes have been there in the past for a wall. Heck, Chuck Schumer voted for a wall. Barack Obama voted. I mean, you can go on the list. I mean, that's the thing that the Republicans have, is they have Democrat after Democrat who are in Congress right now.
Then they should put it up for a vote.
And they have in the past supported it. But now that it's Donald Trump's wall, they're not going to support it. And it just looks what we hate, both parties hate most about Washington, which is just opposition for the point of opposing.
Just,
and it's just a partisan block.
True.
That's what's going on here.
It doesn't work, though, Rick. I mean, that's the point. And you know what?
Are you suggesting
from the perspective
the barriers
of
aren't
people,
important?
Two to one, people will blame Donald Trump and the Republicans for a shutdown in this. Americans don't see this as a priority. 69% of Americans say this should not be a top congressional priority.
CBP says they need the barriers. Hold on a second, Rick. CBP says they need the barriers. The barriers are helpful. They also say you guys are hyper-focusing on one aspect of a very complex problem.
Because he campaigned on it, and the Democrats don't want to give it to him. That's the bottom line here.
But the American public knows that. He's responsible because he's pitching it so that he can tell the American people, I got a brand new wall built. And you know there is no new wall. There's only a continuation of the types of fencing and the different structures and the technologies that they want in different places that they need fixed and added to. There is nothing new. There is no additional, right? I mean, it's just more of what we already have.
$5 billion for nothing new? $5 billion?
That becomes the concern.
If it shuts down,
because this is not a political argument, Jennifer, just so you understand. I spend a lot of time reporting on this, Rick. And I'm telling you, the idea of what we were told during the campaign, which is right where we see all the big barrier fences, and sometimes they put some heavy masonite on top of it, you know, extra little kicker there to make it tough to get over, that you're going to see a brand new wall put in front of that one. That's not true. Those types of structures that we saw they had to put down in San Ysidro and they need more of it, that's what they're talking about. And the president sold it as something different during the campaign, and he said Mexico was going to pay for it, and you say, well, that was never relevant to me. Yeah, of course not. But he is responsible for making the wall into something that it isn't, and the Democrats are responsible for fighting the idea overall, and I think to their disadvantage, Jennifer disagrees. Make your point.
You've just made the point that the president has moved. Because what the president has said is, you know, we're going to put the money in, as you just described, in places that the border folks believe will be effective.
But as you said, the Democrats funded that. Republicans have funded that. Everybody's funded that.
But they're not funding it to the extent that the president promised.
So it's about more, not about new.
It's about more. It's always been about more. It's about more border protection, and that is a key part of keeping the number of illegal immigrants down.
See, I think the idea of fighting the wall, Jennifer. Everybody you talk to down there who's doing the job of keeping us safe, they all say barriers matter. They say it's not a panacea, you know, because once you fix the walls, if nobody could ever get in illegally that way, you're now going to have more pressure on the ports of entry than ever before, and the rules don't match the resources, and they're going to be even more crushed, and there are going to be a lot of ugly situations.
And Chris, why aren't we looking at the cause of this? We end up removing help from countries that are among the top five most violent in the world. Who can blame people for wanting to protect their families and get out of gang-ridden, violent, murder-prone countries?
I get it.
Who can blame them? But why aren't we figuring out how to get to the root of the problem and not just addressing a $5 billion symptom that is not effective?
And this is an area I would agree with you, Jennifer, and you're absolutely right. This country, under the last three administrations, has ignored Central and South America. And Bush did it for a reason, because he was fighting a war. But the Obama administration let Venezuela go to seed, Nicaragua, Honduras, all of this, and did nothing. In fact, promoted the leftists who have been ruining these economies. So you can say, oh, we should do something now. But you got to take responsibility for the last 8 years of disastrous foreign policy for Central and South America.
Let me tell you, fine. Let's always look backwards when convenient. But the president has said he wants to pull more money from these same countries.
I
got to tell you, I think it's going to be tough for you to get people in your party that call themselves Trump supporters to justify giving money to people that he's demonized. I think it's going to be a really tough sell. But we'll see. I appreciate the arguments on both sides, as always. Jennifer Granholm, Rick Santorum, if I don't see you, Merry Christmas. The best of your families.
Merry Christmas. Yeah.
All right.
Thanks.
I want to turn to something that I shared on Twitter, and you may have as well. I'm going to save the best part of the moment for the other side of the break. But I'll tell you what, it's all about the holidays, the holy days, and it gave me one of the biggest ideas I've had. Next. All right, so this boy wanted one thing for Christmas, and he got it. Watch this.
What is it?
What is it? What is it?
It just kills me. Kills me every time. I've watched it like a dozen times. Let's bring in Don Lemon. Look, we've seen these before. They get me every time that these men and women give up everything. Their kids are home. They're waiting for them. They don't know when they're going to see them. All the fear, all the frustration. What a moment. What a moment.
You're a big wuss, that's why.
We asked so much from them.
I'm joking. It is. How could you not cry with that? But the only thing is that is a brave kid, because the moment I saw something crawling around in there, I would have been on the other side of the room, Chris. Until I figured out it was my dad. But look at him. He's like looking. He doesn't even flinch. He's like, what's in there?
I love all of these.
That's
I love when they show
right
up
there.
When they show up at graduations, when they show up in the gyms, and I just love it. I love that these moments are able to be made possible. He's a badass, of course. Who knows how long he was in that box? I would have been freaking out if I were the guy waiting in the box. I wouldn't have been able to handle it. It gave me an idea. I had an idea. Listen to this.
You do that with your family.
Why can't the... No, they'd never open the box. If they knew I was in there, they'd like immediately put it in a truck and put it in the ocean. The idea of these kids, active duty kids and veterans kids, They should be able to write letters,
right?
Not just to Santa Claus,
mm-hmm.
but to an organization that's called a Grateful Nation.
Right.
And they should be taught that the rest of us owe them for what their family is about. And they should be able to write for what they want. All we do in this society is raise money for charitable efforts, right? Nobody comes through. And I did some checking. On the local level, you'll find things in your communities where people help out kids of veterans, and they're beautiful organizations. You look, you'll find them on the local level. But there's not a huge one. There's not a huge one that does only that, Don, so that this kid, let's say he wanted a PlayStation 4, okay? His parents shouldn't have to think about getting it for him. It should be on us. He should write a letter to a Grateful Nation. We should raise money. That's all this country does, raises gazillions of dollars when people are in need. We always say we support the troops. We don't right. do a damn thing for them. We can't even get their VA payments right. These people, the one promise we give them is that you'll be able to go to school. Congress tries to screw with their ability to pass them on to their kids. Now they're not getting their payments. Even where they live, they're not going to have them until 2019, the middle of the year. It's a joke. But what an idea that would be. I want to talk to big charities. Well, I don't, you know, look, we can't be in the charity business here, but they should do that. And I would definitely donate, because why should these kids be denied anything with what their parents give up?
I think you're right. I do think that there are organizations that do help out.
And, they do, and, but not on but a not huge on the- level.
Right. You're saying that they should, like, Santa's list should be taken care of.
Yeah, you got Toys for Tots. You got a lot of beautiful and amazing organization, yeah. many geared towards veterans, especially when someone falls in the line of battle, in the line of duty. But I think it could be bigger than that. I think that we have to start culturally reminding people that it's not just words, because we're really getting there. This VA stuff, Don, I'm telling you, it's scary.
Yeah,
what Congress is ignoring, what they're not jumping up and down about, we're screwing these veterans, and nobody's doing anything about it.
Well, and we should be doing more, and we should be talking more about it. And listen, I think the onus is on all of us to do more and to go visit the VA hospitals. And even hospitals like even you, St. Jude's and Shriners, what they do for kids. I think there's so much more that we could do for this country. Yes, you're right about veterans. Yes, you're right. Those kids' Christmas lists should be taken care of every year. There is enough in this country. There's so much waste. We waste 40% of our food. Just think about it. Let's just be honest. Just think about yesterday, the lunch that you and I went to. We had pizza. We went home with more stuff. You probably put the pizza in your refrigerator. I know that I put the extra pizza in my refrigerator. I'm probably not going to eat it. I'll go next week and I'll look at it and I probably won't eat it. There are families who are starving in this country, and it's not just me and you. It happened. We all do it, and I think we could all be better. I think
true.
You're right.
True. Sadly, I went crazy on that pizza last night at about 11:30. I should have left it alone.
Okay, can I tell you a secret?
It was a mistake, yes.
So after we saw you, we went to Townline.
You went to a barbecue joint after that.
We went to Townline, and then after Townline, 2 hours later, we came back, decorated the tree, then we ordered Chinese.
What the heck? Pregnant?
What do you say? Feed a cold, starve a fever. I'm feeding whatever it is.
Yeah, you took care of that.
Oh, my gosh. My appetite is out of control. So there you go.
D-Lemon.
Basically, I'm a pig. So listen, we got a lot of good stuff coming up, but I won't say it. You're right about that. We'll let the show take care of itself. Figure out a way to do that. Somebody out there, and get in touch with Chris Cuomo.
Yeah, hit me on Twitter. Let's have a conversation about it, you at home. Don, thanks, brother. I'll see you in a second. A Grateful Nation. Take care of these kids. You say you want to do it. You say you care so much, and we always fall short. All right. Now, I talked about this a little earlier in the show. Why is Rudy Giuliani saying these things you hear from lawyers all the time? He's making these crazy statements. He's never made a crazy statement. He's been preparing for something that people didn't realize, but we did. And we're right where we thought we were going to be. I got a closing argument for us that points the way forward. Next.
CNN Tonight with Don Lemon, coming up next.
So, former prosecutors and practicing attorneys, so many of them, noticeably nonplussed by what Rudy Giuliani says. They see it as malpractice. He's laying out inconsistencies. A prosecutor will feast on these. Doesn't have to rhyme, but that's their point. The president and his lawyers, however, they were never planning for a trial. They are preparing for political battle. They are planning to pitch you, not prosecutors. That's what they're doing. They want to cloud whatever is revealed to keep the country from a consensus about what it should all mean, especially for holding the president to account. That's why the president keeps tweeting and abuses the facts with seemingly reckless abandon, because that's exactly what he has. That's why his lawyers admit to things that the president denies. And they keep defaulting to the idea that if it's not clearly a crime, then it's okay. Why? Because they're not worrying about Mueller or being under oath in these efforts. The president chickened out of that a long time ago. His puffery about wanting to go at it with Mueller in person with a, remember that? It's as real as his promises about Mexico paying for the wall. And in fact, both were made for the same reason. Sound strong, and I'll never have to deliver. Listen to this.
I have nothing to do with Russia. To the best of my knowledge, no person that I deal with does.
That was a bold face lie. He didn't say that to Mueller. You heard Giuliani on ABC yesterday, right? With all but a smile on his face. To Mueller, he thinks back and listens. Oh, I think that we put it so that the communications with Cohen about the Russia deal, they went well into November of that year, of the election year. Wait a minute. That's completely contradictory to what the president just said. Well, you don't think they know that? Why would they contradict the president of the United States? Because they don't care about the lie. Because they think you don't care about the lie. That if it's not a crime, it's not obvious, it's not just collusion with Russia, whatever that means, you'll be okay. He never paid a dime to those women. Oh, wait, the payments? Oh, yeah, no, they were all paid back. He knew nothing about those payments. Oh, wait, no, he knew. Oh, but he didn't direct them. Kellyanne must have said it a dozen times. It's as irrelevant to the law as it is untrue. He knew, he directed, he wanted them paid, he knew about the scheme, he knew it was wrong. All the facts show it. So, the president wants to keep clear one thing. Give me the benefit of the doubt. We don't want to go through all this. Hence the morass of mendacity. They're banking on not being held to account because you won't know what to believe, in large part because the president is going to keep lying to you and his lawyers are going to make it confusing, and they're good at it. This is why I have the president's lawyers on, to defend and test the notions. I may not do it well enough, but that's what my effort is, to let you see what it's about, to let you see through it, how they default to deflection, how they immediately demonize me for asking about their contradictions. This is just starting. That's why I'm saying it tonight. Rudy made a big statement yesterday. He let you know they gave different answers to Mueller than the American people get from the president. The report's not going to be the end. It's going to be the beginning of a political punch fest. And in the irony of ironies, for all the investigating and all the hearings that are going to have and the gazillion pages of documents I'll read to you, you know what the deciding factor in all this may be? The measure we like the least, polls. Lawmakers, especially GOPers, are going to be desperate to see if you want them to be Republicans or Republicans when it comes to impeachment. It's all going to come down to you. Here's the good news. I'm comforted by that. I don't like the polls, but I'm comforted that it's on you. I trust you to smell BS and put the proper emphasis on things and put it all in the proper context, which is serving your interests. That may mean doing something, may mean doing nothing. We don't know enough at this point to go any further than that responsibly, but we soon will. And I'll be here to help you separate fact from fugazi, but know what game is being played. Thank you for watching. CNN Tonight with D. Lemon starts right now.
There's a lot of fugazi going around.
Yes.
And if you don't believe there's fugazi right now, there's no help.
There's so much fugazi. I'm waiting for Bill Fugazi to walk in right now.
There is no hope. I mean, there are still people. The president didn't lie. He already told you he lied. He admitted to lying. And then he said, if I.